Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face covering should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is health and social care. I remind members that questions 2 and 8 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button or indicate so in the chat room by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And to get as many questions in as possible, I would obviously prefer short, succinct questions and answers to match. And I call question number 1, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress it has made on the commitments in its programme for government to tackle the consumption of tobacco, alcohol and unhealthy food and drinks.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
We are committed to taking bold population-wide approaches to reduce the significant harms of tobacco, alcohol and unhealthy food and drinks, which is why we will introduce a public health bill during the course of this Parliament. We are in the process of developing an updated tobacco action plan to reduce smoking rates to 5% or under by 2034. We are also driving forward our alcohol framework, which contains 20 actions to reduce alcohol-related harms and embeds the WHO's focus on tackling the affordability, availability and attractiveness of alcohol.
Brian Whittle.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I think a healthy diet from an early age is a major contributor to tackling inequality and the stubborn attainment gap, as I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary would agree. And given there is such a disparity across the country in food provision within our schools, and with so much public procurement purse going towards importing inferior foods, despite the high quality of food produced by our own farmers, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it is time the Scottish Government's public procurement policy ensured that produce available through the Central Excel contract, wherever possible, is of high quality homegrown food to the betterment of our children's health and wellbeing?
Cabinet Secretary.
I certainly agree with much of what Brian Whittle was saying and the importance of not just the availability of healthy food, but of course it's a relative price compared to unhealthy food as well. I'm more than happy to have these conversations with my colleagues in government, particularly Ivan McKee, who I know leads on many of these matters. I'm sure when we do introduce that public health bill, which of course is a programme for government commitment, we will engage of course widely with colleagues right across the chamber. I'm sure Brian Whittle will want to be part of those conversations, but I'm happy to take away the suggestions, constructive suggestions that Brian Whittle makes.
Supplementary from Carol Mochan, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has committed to halve childhood obesity by 2030. Can the Minister outline what steps the Government is taking to make community sport more inclusive, accessible and affordable for families who cannot afford the expensive costs of participating in sport, to ensure that sport plays its rightful role in meeting the targets the Government have set out?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Karen Mochan for, again, what is a really important intervention and contribution. In terms of some of the commitments we made in the PFG to help to get us towards that target of having childhood obesity by 2030, we committed 650,000. That's been available to help health boards and local partners support services which encourage and reinforce good nutrition, healthy eating habits, but also, importantly, physical activity for children under 5 and their families. And it goes back to the point that was made, Brian Whittle, earlier in terms of early intervention in that regard. So we do fund some of that funding does go towards physical activity for children under 5. However, I will write to Ms Mochan with further detail of what we're doing to make sport as inclusive as possible, particularly for those that may find difficulty in participating because of the financial barriers.
Supplementary, Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. According to research conducted by the Alcohol Alliance UK in 2020, more than 70% of alcohol labels do not include the low-risk drinking guidelines, despite the industry reaching a voluntary agreement with the UK Government to do so. Meanwhile, the Scottish Government's own research has indicated that only 17% of people in Scotland are aware of the Chief Medical Officer's low-risk drinking guidelines. People deserve to know what they are consuming and aware
Could
of the harm...
Could we have a question, please, Ms Mackay?
Will the Cabinet Secretary consider mandating nutrition and health information on alcohol labels to enable people to make informed choices?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, we're always happy to look at constructive suggestions that come from any part of the Chamber. I should say I also have good Four Nations discussions with the other health ministers on these issues. And, of course, I have had recent discussions with Minister Ed Argar in relation to the Health and Care Bill that he is introducing, but, of course, touches upon devolved competencies. Now, we haven't got an agreement on the LCM on that, but some of that does stray into the issues that Gillian Mackay raises. So I'm happy to look at any suggestions that are made, including the one that Ms Mackay makes.
A supplementary, Willie Rennie.
On alcohol, I've been a strong supporter of minimum unit pricing. The evidence is pretty clear that it's had a significant impact, but the value of the 50 pence rate has been eroded by inflation in recent years. So when is the Minister going to increase the minimum unit pricing beyond 50 pence?
Cabinet Secretary.
So you'll know that we keep that under review, and I don't think the points that Willie Rennie is making are unreasonable at all. And so we will keep that under review. Forgive me, I don't have to hand when that next review is absolutely due, but we will keep that under regular review, and I will write to Mr Rennie once we have undertaken that review and, of course, what the outcome of that review is.
Question number two, Russell Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what it's doing to ensure that patients have access to dental treatment.
Cabinet Secretary.
I've recently written to the profession about our plans for the recovery of NHS dental services. This letter detailed a package of new improvements to support NHS dental teams in tackling the backlog of care, including enhanced examinations for all patients, both children and adults. This builds on recent funding announcements of £7.5 million for new dental drills and £5 million for ventilation improvement. Our commitment as a government is to build back NHS dentistry and ensure that NHS dental teams are focused on tackling the significant backlog in patient care. That is our immediate focus. It is on recovery, followed by further reform once we have the sector stabilised. Reform at this stage would be a disruption. The purpose of the successful measures that we have introduced have been to ensure that NHS dental services emerge well-placed to care for the oral health of the whole population and can be returned to increased patient-facing contacts as the wider public health position allows.
Russell Findlay.
BDA Scotland say that 4 in 10 Scottish dentists could quit the NHS if Scottish Government COVID payments are withdrawn. They further say the Cabinet Secretary could be remembered as the man who killed dentistry in Scotland. I'm sure they'll be relieved that they are going to get a reply to their October 15th letter, but does he intend to sit down with them and discuss some of these serious concerns?
Cabinet Secretary.
BDA will be in a meeting that I'm hosting later on this afternoon, actually, with a number of staff side representatives. I've engaged with the BDA before. I don't recognise the claims in relation to some of what the BDA have suggested. Of course, I'm keen to learn more about their survey results. But we have invested in the dental sector quite significantly in the course of the pandemic. For example, we provided £50 million of financial support payments in addition to in between £30 and £35 million for free PPE. And that's on top of the figures I mentioned previously around the £7.5 million for new dental drills and the £5 million for ventilation improvements. So we're funding the dental sector as best we possibly can. We're not going to withdraw this emergency support payments all of a sudden. We are looking to do that in April next year. So it allows time to move from the emergency payments that we have currently to a more sustainable model for funding. But I'm happy to engage with the BDA on this issue to discuss it further.
Question number eight, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to claims by the British Dental Association Scotland that, quote, plans to return NHS practices to pre-COVID models of work may devastate dental services.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I said, I've recently written to the profession about our plans for recovery, and if that letter is not publicly available, I'll put that letter into SPICE so members can look at it for themselves. Our commitment as a government is, as I've said, to build back NHS dentistry to recover, and then, of course, to also look at reform. But wholesale reform of the dental sector at this stage would be severely disruptive. I won't rehearse and re-emphasise everything I've said in terms of the investment we have made, but it has been substantial, and that is in order to, of course, support the sector during this difficult time.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. I plan to ask about the government's commitment to maintaining support for practices in rural and island areas, yet David McCall of BDA Scotland has warned of a potential mass exodus of NHS dental services across Scotland. So will the Health Secretary now withdraw his proposals and think again? And given how badly these negotiations have gone, does he still have confidence in his chief dental officer?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, of course, I do have great respect and confidence in Tom Ferris, our Chief Dental Officer. What I would say to Lee MacArthur is that I don't recognise some of the claims being made by the British Dental Association. I'm keen to try to test those with them further, but clearly they have done a survey. I'm very clear in my response to Russell Finlay and to Lee MacArthur that I want to sit down with the BDA. My door will be open to them for further negotiation. And I just re-emphasise the point. The emergency payments, we're not dropping them off the edge of a cliff next week, next month, or even this year. We're talking about potentially moving to a position of withdrawing those emergency payments at the 1st of April next year. We're hopefully, I would hope certainly, and we can never be sure about these things, but hopefully we'll be out of the grips of the emergency phase of the pandemic. However, given that the BDA have said what they've said, given the questions that have been asked by both Russell Finlay and Lee MacArthur, I can confirm that I will continue my engagement with the BDA to hopefully get to a position where we can all agree to the future recovery of the dental sector.
And supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many of my Argyll and Bute constituents who live on islands have to travel to the mainland for dental treatment, which can be expensive, while those islands which have dental practices can struggle to get necessary staff. Could the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the work the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that patients in island communities have access to affordable dental treatment?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can thank Jenny Minto for her question. I'm not sure if I have to declare an interest necessarily, because I do have two cousins that own a dental practice in one of the islands in Jenny Minto's constituency, and I hear from them very regularly, as you can imagine, on all matters related to islands and dentistry. But I can confirm that the Scottish Government is looking closely at the issue of access to NHS dental services in remote and rural areas. We have done over the course of our time in government. The Scottish Dental Access Initiative grants are available in those areas of Scotland where there are access challenges. These grants provide practices with capital funding to support new practice builds or indeed the extension of existing premises subject to NHS care. Currently, we're conducting a review of the areas within Scotland that qualify for that support. We also have in place a range of recruitment and retention incentives that pay up to £25,000 over a two-year period to newly qualified dentists who decide to practice in areas with access challenges. Payments are also made to dentists who return to the workforce after a break of 5 years or more. So we're currently presently considering new areas to be included for these incentives.
Question number three, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking in response to reports of patients being given appointments for COVID-19 booster vaccine with 6 months of their second dose of the vaccine and were unable to have their booster at the appointed time.
Cabinet Secretary.
COVID-19 booster vaccinations in Scotland started as soon as possible once the JCVI provided advice which stated that the booster dose should be offered no earlier than 6 months after completion of the primary vaccine course. People in Scotland are currently being invited for their autumn-winter vaccinations, and to date we followed JCVI advice inviting those eligible for boosters in the same priority as the initial vaccination programme. Those who are eligible can receive their COVID-19 booster and flu vaccine at the same appointment. We are maximising co-administration where possible. Those who completed their primary course of the COVID-19 vaccine less than 6 months ago were only offered the flu vaccine and asked to make a follow-up appointment in some cases for their COVID-19 booster from a given date. Following updated advice to support operational flexibility, in some cases those attending for their flu vaccine can now be offered a booster from 5 months. The COVID-19 booster vaccine will help extend the protection against severe COVID-19 disease gained from the first two doses, specifically against hospitalisation and death over this winter period.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but I've been contacted by dozens of constituents who are finding navigating the system confusing, if not impossible. But let me just give him the example of just one, my mother-in-law. She's been waiting weeks past the six-month point for her COVID booster. She's been calling the helpline every single day to no avail until today. And I checked with her. She received a letter today offering an appointment at 7 a.m. tomorrow morning. Now, she can make that appointment, which is different to the situation for her flu jab. She was offered an appointment in Gore Bridge, which is two buses away and a two-hour round journey for a woman who lives by herself and is over the age of 70. And she's not alone. Constituents are finding
the situation confusing,
lacking info and a helpline that doesn't help. Does the Cabinet Secretary think that this is good enough? And if not, what is he going to do to fix it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, a couple of points for me. First of all, we are administering a record number of flu and booster vaccines in our autumn winter programme. I appreciate that in some areas that hasn't worked as well as it should do, and I don't know if Mr Johnson was present in the Parliament and Chamber for my statement yesterday in response to his colleague Jackie Bailey. I acknowledge the fact that when you administer close to 500,000 flu and booster vaccines, there are cases where it doesn't work and doesn't work well. My offer to every single member is that if there are particular issues that are not being resolved by the Health Board, I'm more than happy for them to come to me. In terms of the case that he raises about his own mother-in-law, no, I'm sorry to hear about the difficulties that she had. I'm pleased that she's able to make that appointment tomorrow, but no, I wouldn't expect people to receive a letter for an appointment necessarily with less than 24 hours to go. But I reiterate the point that I made yesterday. Our booster programme, our flu, our autumn-winter vaccination programme is going at some incredible pace, and there has been some glitches, I know, particularly in areas of Lothian. If I can help any members to resolve those issues, then I'm more than happy for them to contact me directly.
Before I call the next question, could I remind members that I'm looking for succinct questions, and remind the Cabinet Secretary we're looking also for succinct answers. Question number 4, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken and will take to support the mental and physical health for ethnic minority women who are victims of domestic abuse.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's myself, Presiding Officer.
Sorry, Minister.
Thank you. We continue to invest significant levels of funding in specialist frontline services. Our new Delivering Equally Safe Fund recently confirmed allocations to 13 projects specifically supporting minority ethnic women who have experienced domestic abuse and gender-based violence. Following our Mental Health and Transition Recovery Plan, we commissioned research from the Improvement Service to help us better understand and address the mental health and wellbeing needs of women and girls experiencing gender-based violence. This has included engagement with minority ethnic groups, and a final report with recommendations will be published this winter.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Minister for that response. Annie ESO is an organisation working in my Annie'sland constituency which supports women in these difficult circumstances, and they've reported that the domestic abuse of women in ethnic minority communities often goes unreported in Scotland due to religious or cultural reasons. What measures are in place or can be put in place to ensure that these women are able to access the support you have outlined?
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think that domestic abuse has a devastating impact on victims, and we continue to encourage all those who experience these crimes to report it and seek support. We remain committed to raising awareness of domestic abuse, and later this month we'll launch a campaign to reach those most at risk and ensure survivors are aware of the support that continues to be available. We support Scotland's Domestic Abuse and Forced Marriage Helpline, which is there to support anyone with experience of domestic abuse. The helpline is available 24/7 and offers translation services for service users who prefer a language other than English. And Presiding Officer, I launched at Sahelia here in Edinburgh the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund, which seeks to promote the mental health and wellbeing of communities with a particular focus on at-risk groups locally, and this includes ethnic minority women. And the government is also funding research exploring South Asian women's end-to-end experiences of criminal justice in the context of domestic abuse, including seeking support during and following domestic abuse. And we expect this report to be published in December 2022.
Supplementary, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One quarter of cases in the Sheriff Court are domestic abuse cases. But currently one of the main barriers to victims of domestic abuse taking their abuser to court is the cost, as well as access to a lawyer who specialises in domestic abuse. Can I ask the Minister if he has, or if he will do, have discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and the Minister for Justice on how we can improve access to legal aid, as well as ensuring that women can access a lawyer who specialises in domestic abuse?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, as Ms McNeill has rightly pointed out, this is more of a matter for my Justice colleagues. I, of course, have have conversations with them on a regular basis, and we'll pick up with them the points that Ms McNeill has made. What I should say to the Chamber is that I am sure that we are all extremely supportive of Scotland's equally safe strategy, and we want to make sure that women and girls who face domestic abuse have all the recourse that they possibly can.
Thank you. Question number five, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what assistance it is providing to NHS boards that are currently experiencing pressures ahead of the winter.
Cabinet Secretary.
I updated Parliament on the 5th of October on how we are supporting the NHS and social care services to alleviate winter pressures, including providing £300 million to help get people the care they need as quickly as possible over the course of the winter period. Yesterday, I announced an additional winter funding of £10 million for health boards to reduce the time people need to spend in hospital so that others can be admitted more quickly. This funding will be targeted towards enhancing local teams through winter, for example, the deployment of expert physio and occupational therapy staff at A&E units to help triage people best treated elsewhere.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Patients and GPs are raising a high level of concerns around the rollout of the COVID vaccine boosters and the take-up of flu vaccinations at a time when health boards are grappling with additional staff shortages and increasing resignations. In my own region, GPs in Alness and Invergordon have now notified NHS Highland that they will be handing back their contract from early next year. Can I ask what the Scottish Government is doing to support GPs and health boards with these issues and to alleviate pressure on hospitals before they face the even greater pressure that will happen in the winter?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there's a significant amount of investment that's gone into our health board areas, but also into primary care. In fact, increased funding into primary care to help with some of the pressures that they're facing. But I can't divorce the fact that can't divorce the pandemic from the current pressures that we're facing. The indirect and direct pressures of the pandemic are clearly being felt right across the NHS, from primary care to acute settings, right into social care as well. And that's why the winter package seeks to address all of those areas, the £300 million I mentioned, including giving additional £28 million from memory to primary care too. So I speak to health boards, as you can imagine, on a regular basis. I speak to colleagues such as the BMA and others that represent doctors about the challenges that they're facing. So this government will leave no stone unturned and will look for help and assistance wherever we can possibly get it, including as we have done with the armed forces who are helping with our vaccination programme, and I'm grateful to them for that.
Supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. Yesterday, the Cabinet Secretary stated, facing these challenges, health and care staff on the front line continue to give their all to keep us safe, and he wanted to take that opportunity to reiterate his appreciation and gratitude for their enduring efforts. This, along with the £10 million that he announced, will not and cannot help those staff today, tomorrow, or over the coming weeks. Last-minute redeployment of nurses and allied health professionals between departments in hospitals or different hospitals in the same board is very common and has been for some time. Now this is to include physiotherapists and occupational therapists to A&E departments to help triage and treat patients who would otherwise have to see nursing staff.
Could we have a question, please?
Thank you. However, these specialist roles have very different levels of expertise. What support and training are the Scottish Government providing to upskill healthcare professionals who are redeployed to A&E departments from clinical services elsewhere to keep patients and staff as safe as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we will be aware that there are physios that are present, of course, in acute settings. They are very skilled at what they do, and their level of skill and training that they will bring to emergency departments will help to ensure that those that do come into A&E departments with musculoskeletal conditions, for example, can be treated in a way that is best appropriate. But of course, we will continue to work with health boards and around the skilling that is required. What I would say to Ms Webber is I am grateful for her question, because it gives me another opportunity to thank our health and social care staff for all they do for us. That's why that's why we have record numbers of staffing in Scotland, but also the best paid staff than any other country in the UK when it comes to NHS and social care staff.
Question number six, Jim Fairley.
To ask the Scottish Government what measures are in place to support people who have experienced long-term mental or physical harm as a result of NHS negligence or misdiagnosis.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government expects NHS Scotland to provide high-quality healthcare that is safe, effective and person-centred. When unintended or unexpected harm occurs, the relevant healthcare provider will provide appropriate medical support and care that addresses the needs of the patient for as long as it is required. An individual can make a complaint against a healthcare provider and can consider seeking compensation where that is appropriate. Legal advice and assistance can be sought through the Law Society of Scotland, and legal aid is available to those who, of course, pass the financial criteria. Compensation payments for clinical negligence take into account both physical and psychological harm that may be caused.
Jim Fairley.
Yeah, my constituent has suffered psychological and physical abuse as a result of the historic treatment of children with type 1 diabetes at the Cruachan home in Balerno. Can I ask that the Cabinet Secretary urges the Health Board to meet with my constituents so they can get the redress and closure that they so desperately deserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't know the details of the case that Jim Fairley mentions, but I would expect Health Boards to be engaging. And if that isn't happening, then of course I'm happy offline to get the details from Jim Fairley and do what I can to encourage that engagement.
Question number 7, Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it has put in place to ensure that COVID-19 vaccine trial volunteers have the same access to public events and travel as other people.
Cabinet Secretary.
All clinical trial participants who are part of a currently non-approved vaccine or are on a blinded study were sent a paper record of vaccination certificate in September to use in place of the app. These certificates are fully equivalent to the digital version and can be used for access to domestic venues and will also permit smoother inbound entry to the UK. Well, at the moment, the app does not cover clinical trials. We're working to include participant data for use in the app.
Sandesh Gohani.
On the 2nd of September, the First Minister stated that nobody participating in vaccine trials, and I quote, will be disadvantaged in any way. And this position has been repeated at least 5 times. However, Dr. Roy Sosa, leader of the Novavax trial, tells me there is no question the trialists for this vaccine have been disadvantaged. Will the Cabinet Secretary give me an assurance that when the MHRA approves Novavax vaccine, likely within weeks, that people participating in this trial will have their vaccine status recognised on the Scottish vaccine passport within a month?
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, when or if that vaccine is approved by the MHRA, of course, we'll work as quickly as we possibly can to make sure that our app is able to register that vaccine. I know my officials are working hard on that in the case that any of the non-approved vaccines are approved by the MHRA. So, of course, we'll do that as quickly as we possibly can.
Thank you. We'll now move to portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. And I remind members that questions 2 and 6 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. Question number 1, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government to what extent it takes local government decision-making into account when considering proposals previously rejected by a local authority.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand that officials unsuccessfully tried to obtain clarification from Mr Green's office on what proposals he is referring to in this question. In the absence of that clarification, I have assumed that Mr Green is referring to planning decision-making, which is the responsibility of the Planning Minister, Mr Arthur. The Government is committed to seeing the right developments in the right places, and as Mr Green knows, the right to appeal certain decisions by planning authorities is an important part of the planning system, and independent reporters make the final decision on the vast majority of appeals. Independent planning reporters take full account of the planning authority's position, alongside that of other parties involved, including members of the local community.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? He may be aware, and if he's not, let me explain that North Ayrshire Council unanimously cross-party rejected a local wind farm proposal recently. That decision has been referred to ministers. I suspect that no comment will be offered on that specific case. But, Presiding Officer, given that last year half of all local government decisions called in by ministers were overturned, what confidence should the people of North Ayrshire have that local decision-making and views are ever truly respected by this government, whichever minister chooses to answer it?
Minister.
Of course, we as a Parliament, passed a bill on this matter in 2019, but I need to make very, very clear, first of all, to Mr Green and the Chamber as a whole, that, of course, ministers cannot comment on live planning issues under the Ministerial Code, and that is right and proper. I appreciate that Mr Green has raised a specific issue, but I would encourage him to contact the Minister for Planning, and we will, of course, certainly make Mr Arthur aware of the issues that have been raised today. I'm sure if Mr Arthur were here, he would also wish to state to Mr Green that in the last financial year, reporters issued 135 planning appeal decisions, granting planning permission to almost 50% of occasions. In the same period, local planning authorities in Scotland decided approximately 25,000 planning applications, granting planning permission in 94.5% of cases. Thank you.
Supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Tories both rejected third-party right of appeal and supported the right of appeal for developers when this Parliament passed the 2019 Planning Scotland Act. Whilst believe the Rickhill Wind Farm development in my constituency, which is actually what this is about, should not be approved, does the Minister agree that independent reporters should be able to look afresh at this proposal, and that for Scottish ministers to be accused of interference by a Tory MSP is a bit rich, given his Westminster bosses continued meddling in devolved matters?
Minister.
Just reiterate, Deputy Presiding Officer, that ministers cannot comment on live planning issues. However, I note the points that Mr Gibson has made around the process of the Planning Scotland Act 2019, that the considerations around equal right of appeal and the right of appeal to for developers were considered as part of that process, and the Conservatives, of course, rejected the equal right of appeal, voting alongside the government, and also voted for the maintenance of a developer right of appeal, just for clarity. Thank you.
Question number two, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to encourage more affordable homes to be built in remote and rural areas.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robinson.
We recognise that good quality affordable housing is essential to help attract and retain people in Scotland's remote and rural communities. We have committed to delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which 70% will be available for social rent and 10% will be in our remote, rural and island communities, and we'll develop a remote, rural and island action plan to deliver that, plus investing £3.44 billion in this parliamentary term towards the delivery of more affordable homes across Scotland, with £30 million of that investment to support the continuation of Rural and Island Housing Fund.
Finlay Carson.
Thank the Minister for her response. The South of Scotland Community Housing was funded after a study by Shelter identified a shortfall in rural housing supply in Dumfries and Galloway. Providing technical and professional support to 35 communities and landowners, it helps deliver affordable homes that specifically address local needs. Community Land Scotland and Scottish Land Commission have praised the remarkable work and would like to see them upgrade their operations. But the charity now finds itself in a precarious position after the Scottish Government stopped its revenue funding in March 2020. Given its proven track record towards rural housing delivery, I'm sure the Minister would agree this is a ludicrous situation that finds its core funding has been halted. What assurances can the Minister give that its immediate future will not be in doubt?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think what I would want to do is to write to the member on the specifics of the South of Scotland organisation. What I would say is that we want to work with third sector partners, RSLs and social enterprises as well, housing cooperatives, to help us deliver what is a very ambitious programme across Scotland, including in remote and rural Scotland. I'm certainly, as I said earlier, happy to write to the member on the specifics of the organisation it referred to.
Question number six, Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I just draw members' attention to my register of interest as owner of a rental property in North Lanarkshire Council, and to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to a report from Falkirk Council that states that the average cost of building a new affordable home is set to rise to £240,000 from £144,823 in 2014.
Cabinet Secretary.
Current pressures on materials and supplies are contributing to rising construction costs. We're working closely with industry through the Construction Leadership Forum to address the factors behind this. We've also set up a short life working group and working at pace with industry on what solutions Scotland can offer to these global challenges. We operate a flexible grant programme. Local authorities and registered social landlords should apply for the grant funding that they need to deliver affordable housing projects, taking into account their planned level of borrowing and being satisfied that tenants' rents remain affordable.
Mark Griffin.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Even with the Housing Infrastructure Fund now only available to RSLs and local authorities for affordable housing, the proposed urban social rent benchmarks are set at £78,000 and £71,500. That will leave them considerably short. Homes for Scotland advise new homes on brownfield land are often commercially unviable for any housing tenure due to infrastructure constraints. Can the Cabinet Secretary say if the support for regenerating brownfield sites for developments of all tenure goes far enough, or if the Government have any plans to give further support?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I mean, I recognise these issues, and of course we are keeping them under review. In terms of the benchmarks, I'm sure the member will be aware of the work that has been going on with local government and indeed the housing association movement as well. In terms of the new set of benchmarks, they will be adjusted to account for inflation on an annual basis. We, as I said earlier, need to keep these matters under review. The cost pressures, we don't know how short-term or long-term these will be. And as I said in my initial answer, we are working through them and working with the housing sector in order to make sure that we keep the momentum of the affordable housing supply programme going at pace.
Supplementary, Jenny Minto.
Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Highlands and Islands face distinct challenges when it comes to housing. Will the Cabinet Secretary elaborate on the ways in which the Scottish Government is showing flexibility in its support for a sustainable and affordable housing strategy in Scotland's Highlands and Islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Scottish Government housing staff work closely with local authorities and other stakeholders to respond to specific local challenges and locally identified housing priorities. The Affordable Housing Supply Programme does have flexibility to award grants at levels which recognise the development challenges facing rural and island communities, and support is available, as I said in an earlier answer, through the Rural and Island Housing Funds, backed up by £30 million of investment over this Parliament. And together, these funds have supported the delivery of 6,000 affordable homes across rural and island Scotland over the last Parliament. And we remain committed to the Housing Action Plan. I should just say I had a fantastic visit to Fort Augustus, where I saw 12 fantastic affordable homes being delivered for local people.
Supplementary, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. Notwithstanding what the Cabinet Secretary said, figures last month revealed that 900 people in Orkney, out of a population of less than 22,000, are on the housing waiting list, facing average waits of over 2 years. With COVID prompting inward migration and rapidly increasing costs, alongside the proposed removal of local connection from homelessness legislation, does the Cabinet Secretary really believe that the Government is doing enough to assist island authorities like Orkney Islands Council to ensure there's sufficient affordable housing to meet this rising demand?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would say to the member, the scope of what we are doing, I've laid out today on numerous occasions, of the 100,000 homes already delivered and the ambition for 110,000 affordable homes going forward. We need to make sure, though, that those are equitably spread, and that is why we're bringing forward a specific plan for rural and island Scotland that will give an opportunity for members like Liam MacArthur and local community organisations, housing providers within Orkney and elsewhere, to input into that plan in order to address the specific needs of that local area. But the scale of our ambition really, I would think, would be quite hard to dispute.
And supplementary, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As others have said, the issues in the Highlands and Islands are particularly bad, with people moving up to the area because of COVID and buying buy-to-let. Can I ask if she's given any thought to the Hebridean Housing Partnerships initiative to sell houses to local people who will live and work in the area only?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I know that there have been quite a number of quite innovative ways of retaining housing stock within local areas, such as bonds, for example, where if a local person, family purchase a property that it is remains in the local community going forward. Now, these things are not easy and there's not one single solution. Obviously, we are addressing issues regarding short-term lets and secondary letting. Councils already have the powers to introduce control areas. So all of these areas and powers that local authorities have, I think, need to be used according to the needs of a local area. But if the member wants to write to me with more detail of the issue that she raised, I would be happy to give her a more detailed response.
Question number three, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how its housing strategy ensures that all new affordable housing is built to be as energy efficient as possible.
Minister Patrick Harvey is joining us remotely.
Thank you. All new homes delivered through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme meet Scottish building regulations, which set high levels of energy efficiency. We're currently consulting on improvements to these energy standards for introduction next year, and we're strongly focused on reducing overall energy demand in new homes. We'll also aim for all new homes delivered by registered social landlords and local authorities to be zero emissions homes by 2026, which, amongst other things, will mean greater use of off-site construction in the social rented sector to deliver high quality and energy efficient homes.
Gillian Martin.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Given the ongoing rise in energy costs and the impact it will have on many of our most vulnerable people, it is vital that we do what we can to limit the amount of energy that houses require. So I'd like a little more detail on how we ensure that social landlords in particular focus on energy efficiency from the start of the process for all new builds.
Minister.
Well, of course, the Scottish Government does recognise the impact of fuel costs on tenants and the need for new homes to be designed to be as energy efficient as possible. For social landlords, the Affordable Housing Supply Programme supports the delivery of high quality, energy efficient homes and provides additional funding where homes are built to higher levels of energy efficiency than set out in the current building regulations. So that makes homes even more affordable to heat. We're also, as I said in my first answer, reviewing the energy standards through the building regs to deliver further improvements in the energy efficiency and emissions reduction for all new homes. And following the recent review of investment benchmarks, additional funding is also now available to social landlords through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme to install zero emissions at point of use heating systems.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Does the Minister acknowledge that there will be unintended consequences for households living in fuel poverty in off-grid, mainly remote and rural communities, as a result of the decision to halt all installations of energy-efficient oil and LPG heating systems? Many properties in rural and remote Scotland, 20% in fact, are by the Scottish Government's own research identified as not being technically suitable for renewable technologies such as air source heat pumps and ground source heat pumps. So can I ask the Minister what impact assessment was actually undertaken before he made the announcement?
Minister?
Well, no one who had already been given the offer of an LPG or equivalent system has had that offer withdrawn. In fact, all those that were in the pipeline had commitments made. Those commitments were honoured. I think right now, especially while COP is meeting in Glasgow, all of us should be conscious simply continuing with some of the most polluting heating systems available to us is really not an option if we want to support householders in all parts of the country to reduce their emissions. We are continuing to provide a wide range of interventions for those who might previously have been offered LPG systems, and we'll be committed to continuing to review and improve the offer that's available.
Thank you. Question number four, Pauline McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government when it plans to introduce a system of nationwide rent controls.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
The Scottish Government has committed to delivering a new deal for tenants and consult on the options and deliver legislation to implement effective national system of rent controls with appropriate mechanisms to allow local authorities to introduce local measures by the end of 2025. We'll be setting out proposals for taking this work forward in our forthcoming rented sector strategy, which we aim to publish for full public consultation by the end of this calendar year.
Polly McNeill.
I introduced my Fair Rents Bill in the last Parliament that had widespread support, including from the Minister, Patrick Harvey himself. But one of the key aspects to the bill was that private rents should not be able to be raised more than CPI plus one. And I was pleased that David Alexander from the firm DG Alexander suggests in a press release recently that a system where annual rent rises for sitting tenants were capped at inflation plus 1 or 2% could be workable. So I asked the Minister, do we have to wait to 2025 to see some action, at least, to protect tenants who are seeing exorbitant rents across Scotland? And I do wholeheartedly welcome the proposals, but does the Minister agree that we need to do something before 2025? Otherwise, tenants will basically be priced out of their homes.
Minister.
Well, we do have a very full programme of work well before 2025. I commend Polly McNeill for her work on this issue in the last session, and I hope that she will work constructively with the Scottish Government to take forward our full New Deal for tenants under the rented sector strategy. Some of that work under the rented sector strategy will be implemented earlier. Some of it, including the models of rent control, does need proper work to examine the range of options that exist, including those that were put forward in Polly McNeill's Members' Bill. But there are other options as well, other models that we need to examine to get the system right. We've already gone through a process in Scotland of designing and adopting a system of rent controls that didn't work. Rent pressure zones have never been used, never been affected, haven't changed anyone's rent. Let's make sure that we spend the time and consult openly to get the model right. I hope that we'll be able to work constructively with colleagues across the...
Seems to be a technical problem. So I think we hopefully got the gist of the Minister's response, and I think if we... So can the Minister hear us?
Yes, I can hear you fine. Can you hear me?
I can hear you now. I think you froze for a moment, but we'll move on to a supplementary from Alexander Stewart.
Okay. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The effects of rent control policies elsewhere when they were introduced around the world is a very mixed picture. In Sweden, they have led to, reportedly, a second-hand market of sublet properties. Here in Scotland, several industry experts have warned that rent controls are not the answer to Scotland's housing crisis. Can I therefore ask the Minister what analysis has been carried out as to the potential benefits as well as the potential pitfalls of the proposed rent control system?
Minister.
Well, I thank the member for that question. I hope he'll acknowledge that some of the work that we intend to do in developing models and consulting on proposals is intended to do exactly what he's asking for, looking at all of the range of potential benefits and some unintended consequences, how to avoid those. I think there are those in the private rented sector who wouldn't have the kind of instinctive recoil against the principle of rent controls that some might think. And I also hope that the member will acknowledge that simply continuing with a situation where some people in some parts of the private rented sector are frankly being price gouged, that is not acceptable. And we do need to deal with the unacceptable levels of rent increases that some people have been living with.
Supplementary from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the Minister's assurance that reforming the private rented sector remains high on the agenda. Could the Minister provide any more detail on the Scottish Government's work constructing a new deal for tenants? Thank you.
Minister.
Yes, as I've said, Presiding Officer, our forthcoming rented sector strategy will be setting out our ambitious proposals to deliver a new deal for tenants. This was, of course, a commitment in the Scottish Government and Scottish Greens cooperation agreement in August this year. It will include plans for a new housing regulator for the private rented sector, introducing enhanced and new rights for tenants. For example, giving people the ability to decorate their home, to keep pets, you know, some things which really do speak to the dignity of people living in their homes, as well as restrictions on winter evictions and a range of other measures. I look forward to being able to publish this. I hope to have constructive engagements with members across the chamber on the detail.
Thank you. Question number 5, Miles Briggs.
Ask the Scottish Government what support it plans to provide to first-time buyers.
Cabinet Secretary.
First-time buyers can access a variety of support, including the Help to Buy Smaller Developers Scheme and the Low Cost Initiative for First-Time Buyers LIFT. In addition, the First-Time Buyer Relief for Land and Buildings Transaction Tax mean that an estimated 8 out of 10 first-time buyers continue to pay no tax at all.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the fact is that the Help to Buy scheme has been now shut off to first-time buyers in Scotland, unlike in England. And this has resulted in the fact now that young Scots are increasingly being denied the dream of getting onto the property ladder. House builders are saying that first-time buyers are now not presenting across Scotland. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what support do ministers plan to provide to first-time buyers going forward in the budget? And will the Cabinet Secretary also look to restore the Help to Buy scheme in full?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, some context to the fact that there was a 66.5% cut to the Scottish Government financial transactions budget in 2021-22, arising from the UK Government spending review, and that then meant difficult choices had to be made. So we chose to target the limited support available to low-income buyers who are the most marginal by maintaining the LIFT scheme. And I should note the UK Government does not run an equivalent scheme for low-income purchasers. And being more targeted in that support for first-time buyers is important, given the evaluation showed that 72% of first-home fund buyers and 80% of help-to-buy buyers would have been able to purchase a property which met their needs without Scottish Government financial assistance. That is the independent evaluation of that. Now, if Miles Briggs and the Conservatives are saying that they want to shift money away from helping those on lower to moderate incomes purchase a property to those who have more resources at their disposal, then he should bring forward proposals in the budget and tell us where that money is going to come from in order to support those who, as I've just demonstrated with those figures, would be able to purchase a house without Scottish Government assistance.
And question number 7, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government how it ensures that welfare entitlements and other benefits such as council tax exemptions are taken up by care experienced young people.
Cabinet Secretary. Oh, sorry, Minister Ben McPherson.
We are committed to maximising the take up of Scottish benefits among all of those who are eligible, and our approach to this is set out in our latest benefit take up strategy. We are aware of the additional challenges care experienced young people often face in accessing entitlements, and Social Security Scotland is engaging with a range of corporate parents to raise awareness of devolved benefits among this group in line with their corporate parenting action plan. Local authorities have a duty to promote the entitlements they administer, including council tax reduction, and have a statutory responsibility under the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014 to provide continuing care to eligible care leavers.
Thank you, Gillian Mackay. Succinct supplementary and succinct answer, Minister, please. Gillian Mackay.
I have heard from care experienced young people that there are issues around claiming for council tax exemptions for those who leave care between the ages of 16 and 18, even if they leave care during this period and then return. Can the Minister advise if... Apologies. Can the Minister advise if this is the case, and if it is, whether the Scottish Government will seek to address this disparity?
Minister.
In the interest of time, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think Gillian Mackay raises an important point, and I would be keen to take that up with her in correspondence after today's session.
Thank you, Minister. And before moving on to the next item of business, can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus?